This is a new vernacular in the language of cinematography, in the same way that Steadicam, which started off being, gee whiz, I can run with the camera. The technology became more sophisticated. People started to understand creatively how to work with the tool, and it became its own kind of shot, to where now you're looking at a script and you go, ah, this is a Steadicam shot. The same thing is going to be happening with this technology.
All right. Thank you for joining us for the drones panel. I've been looking forward to this for months and months. I think this is going to be the highlight of my fall panelizing schedule. But my name's Scott Kirzner. I write a column called Innovation Economy in the Boston Globe. I run a website called Innovation Leader. I'm fascinated by drones. I don't own a drone yet, so if there's a raffle during this panel, I'm going to put in my business card twice. But have seen a lot of drones flying, and I think I've been following the space since, like, I want to say like 2002 or 2003 when I wrote a piece in Wired magazine, kind of mostly looking at military drones because that's all there were at that point, and the role those were going to play in Iraq War II. So what we want to do is we want to kind of warm up the panel a little bit with a few questions about what's happening now in the world of drones and cinematography, videography, regulations, the FAA, and then we're going to throw it over to you and hopefully answer any questions you want to pose about drones. Let me introduce this panel really quickly. From left to right here, we have Jeff Adams. He's co-founder of Unmanned Aerial Systems Development in Holliston, Massachusetts. They're an R&D and engineering firm. Next down is Andro Amato. He's co-founder and editor-in-chief of DroneLife.com, the lifestyle website for drone. I'm probably misdefining it. Everything you wanted to know about drones on the internet. One down, we have Michael Shambliss. He is the business representative for the International Cinematographers Guild. Second from the end is Colin Murray. He is the flight captain at Dart Drones, a drone flight school in Woburn that offers drone classes all around the country, perhaps the world, perhaps the solar system.
You never know.
And all the way at the end, Christopher Walsh is a partner at Elevated Perspectives Media in Warwick, Rhode Island. Is that true?
That's true.
Wow. So you came the furthest today.
Oh, California.
No. Hey, hold it. I came out of L.A., for crying out loud.
You did?
Yeah.
All right. That's west of Warwick, right?
Yeah.
All right. Hey, so would you give this panel a warm round of applause for showing up today? They're being paid like negative scale to be on this panel. So, hey, the first question
Speak
I want
to my rep first.
What's that?
Speak to my rep first.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, these guys better get paid.
Our agent.
Thought there was a lot of money in drones.
So, Andrew, since you've been running this website, Drone Life, for like 2 years now, right?
Yep.
The leading website about all things drone. Where are we right now? Like, I feel it's very confusing in terms of the FAA rules about what you can do with the drone. I read something recently that said the FAA is going to have sort of the official rules about commercial flying of drones by mid-2016. So what does that mean for today? Like, can you just buy a drone and start some kind of business and no one will care?
Well, the FAA will care. Just don't tell them about it.
Uh-huh.
No, it is sort of the Wild West because there aren't a whole lot of rules. The FAA would tell you there are a lot of rules, but it's kind of just as long as you keep their top five kind of rules in mind, you're pretty much okay. And if you don't hit somebody with your drone, you'll be okay. They won't really come knocking at your door.
So I mean, it's kind of like buying a car, not registering it, not having a driver's license, just like drive safely and probably no one will bother you.
Yeah, pretty much, except... you know, you want, right, good luck. That's the best advice you can give to somebody. Good luck.
Mm-hmm.
The cops will probably come knocking if they see you driving that car, right?
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time, though, it's kind of 50-50. A lot of the times, even on YouTube, you see videos of somebody flying a drone and the police come up, and it's like 50-50. Sometimes they're just like, oh, man, that's really cool. Show me how it works. Other times, it's why are you flying here?
But to follow that analogy, you wouldn't necessarily drive your car legally onto the runways at Logan and get in the way of a passenger jet or something, which in this instance is a lot more possibly on the line than the don't get caught kind of circumstances.
But so, Jeff, we were talking a little bit before. there are a lot of instances of, you know, two guys or two women buying a drone and suddenly they hang out a shingle and they're the drone, you know, two guys videography in Brighton, Massachusetts.
Right, yeah.
Drones for hire.
The real basis of it is that, so the FAA does have rules in place that are designed to support and enhance the safety of the general public. I mean, that's basically their charter from the federal government, is to mandate and control aviation in such a manner that, you know, you and I can walk out in our backyard and have a reasonably solid expectation of not getting hit in the head by a 747. So they have rules in place that prevent or preclude you from using a drone for commercial use, which gets into some question is, why is it restricted for commercial use and not for recreational? Because as before that couple hung out their shingle, they could pretty much fly their drone anywhere in the national airspace, other than the approachways to runways of major airports, with impunity. You know, you buy your son one, give it to him for Christmas, he can be out flying in the backyard the next day, you know, once the battery's charged and once he figures out where the on switch is, he could go out and start doing anything. The regulations were set up such to try and dial that back. The FAA's made some stronger moves towards, they're not charged with regulating recreational use, but they've recently released a much stronger statement of how to limit those
and
things.
And a lot of the first people to get exemptions and the sort of blessing from the FAA to fly drones were Hollywood studios, right, who said, like, we'd rather have the less expensive drone do this shot than a helicopter. I don't know, Michael, Christopher, do you want to jump in and talk about?
I would say one of the easiest things to cover first, maybe if anyone is looking at this as a commercial enterprise, you've heard a lot about the 333 exemption. What happens is, as soon as you collect a check for flying a drone, they're going to treat you like you're an aircraft. You're no longer, you're a drone, but they're going to treat you like you're a 747. That's all there is to it. What the exemption means is that you're exempt from getting your drone inspected for airworthiness. That's all that exemption is. So every time you fly, you have to report to the FAA, submit a flight plan, report to the FISDO 72 hours before and tell them what your flight plan is. If you want to fly in and around the rules of the exemption, you have to apply for amendments. You have to if you get your exemption, you can do whatever you do.
And Christopher, do you have one of those exemptions?
We do.
When did you get it? Like, was it, did, was
we were one of the first, it took a long time. It's very paperwork intensive, and it definitely requires a lot of time and a lot of patience. They've sped up the process since. What it means is you really have to understand the rules and regulations of what the FAA wants from an airplane or any other aircraft, because you have to follow every rule there is for a private Cessna or a 747. What airspace you can be in, how far from an airport are the basics, but it's much more in depth than a lot of, like, the myths about flying a drone commercially. It's not just if you get this exemption, you're now free to collect money and do whatever you want.
And if you have the exemption, does the person flying the drone have to have a pilot's license or any particular training?
You need to have a pilot. You need to have someone with a pilot's license there on hand and part of the operation.
Okay, awake, presumably?
Very much awake and actively participating.
Uh-huh. That person is the pilot in command, which is a very common term used in aviation. And you'd be far-fetched to find somebody who has a pilot's license, wants to let you operate the drone and stand there and be held responsible, ultimately, if something were to go wrong. So more often than not, those are going to be the same thing.
Yeah.
And the FAA has made this distinction between commercial and non-commercial operations for a very long time. And like most bureaucracies, if something works, they just sort of take the round peg and put it in the round hole. Mm-hmm. And I own a small aircraft and I operate it non-commercially. And because of that, there's a whole slew of things I don't have to do that someone who has a commercial aircraft would have to do, even though I could operate it 24/7, and the other commercial guy only operates it 1 hour a day or whatever. Mm-hmm. They've always made that distinction, and they sort of stuck with it.
And to,
I was going to say, because what really goes on here, the exemption is held by an air carrier officially. So you've actually become a commercial air carrier when you get the exemption. And your aircraft have to have a N number, just like any other aircraft. And you have that whole list of regulations, part of which come from the Department of Transportation, not just the FAA. It's a whole thing that way. And there is a whole, when they talk about pilot in command, that is actually a whole area of stuff to know in terms of responsibility, in terms of what is the liability, what is the authority of this person over the air operation. So it's, this really comes from what happens under your exemption is you're really saying, I have an experimental aircraft, and as a commercial operation, I want to fly that experimental aircraft. And that's where all of these rules come in. Now, if you're a hobbyist, you're a hobbyist, and you can go out and design and build any kind of RC model airplane you want and go fly it. You know, and it's so really the difference becomes when you decide to take your first dollar in for doing the work.
Can I just ask in the audience here, like, are there some people who own drones, even if it's a tiny little DJI? So, good. How about you raise your hand if you're considering purchasing one, don't own one now? All right, just raise your hand if you don't own, aren't considering, but have seen them flying in person. All right, good. So this is a pretty knowledgeable audience. I was going to just ask to whip up the fear factor a little bit. You know, there was this, you know, I don't want to paint the picture that, like, as more people are flying drones as hobbyists and commercially, we're going to have, like, drones raining from the sky day and night, you know, and that weathermen are going to give you the drone forecast of, you know, do you need to bring your lead umbrella out today?
It might not be far from that.
And last year, there was this instance in Marblehead. I forget if it was a 4th of July parade or it was some kind of parade in Marblehead. There was a hobbyist who was flying his drone. And the drone fell out of the sky and hit someone on the head. And he had his kid on his shoulders. Mm-hmm. He wasn't injured. The kid wasn't injured. But, like, it does feel like all this FAA regulation, we want it to get us to a place where you're not going to have to worry about, you know, getting injured or your kid getting injured because either some hobbyist or some commercial operator has a multi-hundred-pound thing that's flying in the air.
Yeah, and there are actually a lot more, even more current incidents. There was a drone that crashed into the U.S. Open, you know, down in New York. There's been, there was a child who was hit at an outdoor concert venue recently. And those operators, I kind of fall back on, a lot of that ends up to be recreational or somebody who has a drone and they say, oh, this is going to be a really cool shot and I'm going to just post a video somewhere. You know, they really don't have a skin in the game. They've spent maybe $1,200 to buy a drone and put a camera on it. And they can just fly around because they don't really have any limitations on them. I think myself and all the other panelists here who operate these things commercially, I mean, you've got a tremendous investment in both your equipment and your time and, you know, and whatever assets you're carrying on board. So if you're flying a $150,000 camera system, you're going to be pretty smart about how you're doing that. Mm-hmm. What you see in the reports of a lot of people who have incidents or have issues, I mean, certainly there are big ones that come down on occasion.
And if your N number's on it, they'll figure out that it's you, whereas the hobbyist be like, oh, well, there goes $1,000.
Which is exactly the case with the U.S. Open. Yeah. That was the hobbyist drone fell down and they didn't know who did it, whereas at the other U.S. Open, NBC has been using drones to shoot these giant golf courses, and you haven't heard of a crash there yet because they're
They're probably licensed professionals, and they have the people who have responsibility. You know, I mean, we're set up as a corporation, but I'm certainly sure if something happened with one of our birds, they'd be knocking at my door, finding out how deep my pocket is. So.
Before you jump in, though, the thing that surprised me is I was talking to the guys at Above Summit in Somerville earlier this year, and they said they actually have insurance for their drones, I think for just that reason, right, as they can say, we're insured if anybody gets hurt or any property.
Yeah, I mean, as anyone on any production set, I mean, whether you're hiring a caterer or whether you're hiring a B-camera operator, you know, they're going to come as a company with valid licensing or skills and capabilities and all the insurance behind it. And that's what I think, you know, operators who have gone through the process of getting a 333 and following industry standards, working with the industry to make sure they're all in compliance, that's what we can bring to the table to a production company to say, we want to fly a drone, we want someone who can do it responsibly. And I think that's where hopefully the industry is moving towards. And
you want to jump in, Mike?
Yeah. The bigger picture on all of this is really the democratization of the airspace. Airspace has always been, the access to airspace has always been a select few. You know, there's, you know, 500,000 registered aircraft or so in the United States. Why? Because airplanes, they're really expensive. Even a cheap airplane is really expensive. And this technology all of a sudden opens it up for everyone. And the technology, whether you're looking at motion pictures, agriculture, infrastructure, public safety, It has all of these really incredible implications. But we're very much like, and we had talked about this before the panel, and other folks had made this reference, it's like the introduction of the automobile. There are no stoplights. There's no driver's test. Nobody knows what the rules of the road are. The highways are not constructed for it. And people go, gee, these things are dangerous. You know, and at the same time, you can say, well, a semi-truck is awfully dangerous as well. But once people are, when the infrastructure exists for it and the people who are operating the equipment are properly trained, even if they're not commercial, even if a person knows how to drive their car, we tend to get along pretty well with that. And so, you know, part of it as a culture, part of it as a society that we have to do is realize that we're at the very introductory stage here, and there is a whole thing that we have to build to actually introduce this to the United States.
So you set up Colin really nicely. Colin, can you talk about dark drones? Like, how long is the training? Who is showing up to learn how to fly a drone? Because I think a lot of people, the box shows up from Amazon, they open it up,
sure,
and like,
sure,
they're a
Before
pilot.
That, I wanted to defend the general aviation community and say that my first airplane was $19,000. I split it with a buddy, and that's probably cheaper than most cars that people drive. So it's not like, you know, too
was
fancy.
It, like,
it wasn't a Gulfstream or anything.
Yeah, yeah. World War I era, like canvas.
It was
the
Cessna 150. It had 100 horsepower in 1967 when it was made, so by the time I bought it, probably had like 60 or 70 horsepower. And it was more like a go-kart with wings on the end of it. But anyway.
Okay, so dark drones training, how long is it?
The training can be different. We have in sort of modules, you know, in stages. So depending on what you want to learn about, each module is 2.5 hours, like 2 hours of classroom, and then about an hour of flying time. It's much more, we focus on like the regulations on 333 filing. We focus on airspace and regulations, and because all the instructors are pilots, we're mostly almost doing like a ground school, aviation ground school. It's kind of set up to be what we think the drone license eventually will be. We go over how to contact airports and get permission to operate in their airspace, all that sort of thing that, you know, will end up being on the written test when it comes out. Most of the people that we have sign up are predominantly photography of some nature. And then we have a lot of either hobbyists and then a small segment of law enforcement, sort of civil government people that are bringing it. I had one guy in a recent class who was bringing a bunch of Inspires into his local police department.
And what's the price? Is it like more expensive than a spin class, say?
I've never taken a spin class.
Like, how much is a spin? How about 30 bucks, 20, 20, 30
okay.
bucks?
It's more expensive than a spin class, but not by a whole lot. The first one is about 60 bucks, and then you get edge over 100 bucks for the other classes when you get into the more advanced. The level two, which is primarily about airspace and aviation, that sort of thing, I believe is a little bit over $100.
Yeah. Andrew, I want to ask you a question, and then Michael, maybe you can set up this next video that we're going to watch. So I was reading Drone Life this morning, and there's a story about like, oh, someone was flying a drone in Ireland where they shoot Game of Thrones. Do I have that right? It's Ireland, not
yep.
England?
Yep.
And they got this great drone footage of the set of Game of Thrones, and maybe there are some spoilers, and you can tell like what characters are in the scene and what's going on. Like, what the hell? Like, so you can just fly your drone anywhere and take videos of, I mean, like, do you think those guys could be prosecuted? Or the same thing with like a celebrity wedding. Does someone have to press charges against the drone pilot?
So there's a lot of parts of that question.
Yeah.
First of all, as a Game of Thrones fan, spoilers, man, come on, that's unfair. But yeah, at the end of the day, like when you're in Ireland and Ireland's going to have their own rules and everything, that person's probably not going to get prosecuted. Now, like a celebrity wedding, there's bills in the California State House now going through to protect celebrities. Like if basically the bill says, if you couldn't get that picture standing like with a regular camera and you obtain it via drone, that was obtained illegally.
Mm-hmm.
So those pictures are forfeit, basically. So there's progressive like lawmakers are starting to think about that kind of answer, but it's still, you know, if Kim and Kanye want to renew their vows in Cape Cod, there's nothing really that the police can do about it unless they really go straight to the FAA and say, mm-hmm. you know, we want a no drone zone for this particular area, this uh-huh. particular place, which is possible, but again, it's all paperwork.
A really good example of this is presidential TFRs. And the president comes, when he was in the vineyard, mm-hmm. and it frustrates me because I want to go down to the vineyard and get breakfast or something, and I can't because the president's here. I know it sounds like first world problems.
But so it's basically a no-fly zone the vineyard.
And that no-fly zone is from the surface to 18,000 feet. They don't make qualms about whether you're 5 feet or you're 10 feet. And people flying their drone will be like, well, I'm never on the top of my house. Yeah. The FAA doesn't care about any of that because they need to worry about what the worst possible outcome is. You know, so they see their sort of jurisdiction, or lack of a better term, right down to the blades of grass.
But the problem with that, right, then, is that if somebody who just ordered a DJI Phantom online and then wants to go fly to Martha's Vineyard isn't going to know to check the FAA's website to say, oh, this is a restricted flight zone because Obama is on Martha's Vineyard.
Right.
Right? So it all of a sudden gets very complicated. Yeah, he can absolutely go fly. And he might get shot by the Secret Service. but you kind of like, well, it's a little bit your fault. Yeah.
As you should. But there's also, there's no, even if they do, we're shooting on Purge right now. And we've been shooting for weeks, and we were out there the other night, and someone had a Phantom above set. It's not ours. We're the drone company.
Yeah.
Right.
Can you shoot it down? Can you take offensive actions?
Technically, I have the ability. Right. I mean, I'm a pretty good shot.
I have the ability to shoot it down.
Weather.
Yeah. But there's no way to track that.
Right.
Yeah. There's no tail number. This is where that line between what do you do about hobbyists?
Uh-huh.
What do you do about preserving their rights to do what they want to do? And what do you do about privacy, commercial? This is a huge conversation.
Yeah. Right. I personally think that the distinction between commercial and hobby is what's creating all of this mess. Mm-hmm. Just make everybody get a license. Make everybody get a license, make it all even. And the people, whether hobbyists or not, they could buy 10 drones, who knows what the size is. They should be held to the same standard. Just as though if I fly my plane privately, I'm held to a different standard, but it's a little bit different. I still had to go through a tremendous amount of training.
You know? But if you take off in your Cessna, you should know to check the website that says, like, hey, there are no fly zones around Boston today or Martha's
Vineyard. The difference between my license and a commercial license is like 10 or 15 hours of training. The difference between a drone that someone just buys and has absolutely no training and what the FAA is proposing as potential drone license, that's a huge gap to fill.
Right. Yeah.
So why not just make everybody do the same thing?
So, Michael, let's look at this video. Can you set it up? It's like the drone following drone video. But
I'll set it up for you. I will do a comment, though, on shooting down the drones. I do know that is legal in Texas.
There was just about a week ago, a company has designed a system to take control over a drone.
Yeah, I think Boeing made one, too.
So they now supposedly can set up a geofence, and if the drone enters that space, they can gain control over it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure, again, every 6 months, you could buy a new, better drone. You can buy a new, better anything. Within the near future, there will be many ways to take control of something
when
you don't want
to. When it comes to actual firearms, there's a lot of legal precedents already that is not an appropriate response.
Except in Texas.
Texas.
All right, let's look at this.
The introduction on this video. A lot of people have not seen drones actually in operation, and so this is really a drone doing some very what would be typical television commercial shots, and it is shot from another drone, and the whole purpose of it is, what are we actually talking about when we talk about doing this work?
All right.
That's all right.
If you wanted more about shooting down the drones, Google Johnny Drone Hunter.
Uh-huh.
Have you ever seen that video? It's very worth it. Yeah. It gives you the polar side of the whole anti-drone movement.
All right, let's give this a shot.
I also brought the audio commercial. the point there really is there's a considerable amount of flying skill when you're starting to work that close to objects who are moving at speed.
All right. So I want to ask just one or two last quick questions and then open it up to you. We have some microphones that we're going to run around since we're recording the audio. So get your questions ready. This is just a totally uninformed question, but do you see, Christopher, take a crack at this. I mean, are drones in cinematography a complete replacement for planes and choppers?
Oh, gosh,
and
no.
They're not?
No, it's not a replacement for anything. Helicopters will be able to get shots that a drone, again, shouldn't or couldn't get in a lot of scenarios.
What's an example?
There are high and wide shots of cities that you should not be letting a drone fly over the top of New York City at this point with the technology we currently have. Shouldn't be done.
Mm-hmm.
It's Class B airspace. Drones shouldn't be in there anyway. There's legal issues why that shouldn't be happening. A helicopter is the only thing that can physically fly for the length of time, get as close to the objects that they want. I mean, it's just as we're not going to be replacing Techno cranes anytime soon. Everyone's going to have their own place within the market to still get the shots. We're just adding, like the shots that you just saw, there's no other way to get that. Mm-hmm. You couldn't get those with an ultimate arm. You couldn't get those any other way than using a drone.
And there are some camera rigs that a drone is not going to be able to get in the air today?
We've been flying an Alexa Mini recently. So the technology on the camera end is catching up. So you can have Arri raw footage off of a drone to match what you're getting off of a Steadicam or Techno Crane or Ultimate Arm.
Mm-hmm.
But in 10 years, we may have drones the size of a helicopter, and that may not, it depends how you apply the term drone, I guess.
Yeah. All right, so my last question is just, maybe Andrew, you want to take a first crack at this, like broaden things beyond, what we're seeing today, which is like cinematography, maybe some bridge inspection or building inspection, Amazon obviously talking about, one day delivering packages in, 15 minutes or less with drones. But like, where else do you see it going? And maybe Jeff, you want to jump in there too?
Well, the big one is agriculture. You have big open spaces and, you can put heavy cameras and you can put heavy sensors on, a couple $1,000 drone, cover a lot of space and gather a lot of data on, everything from soil to pesticides, plant health, everything can be gathered in a matter of minutes by a drone, which you'd have to go through the physical field. That's a huge one you see a lot of growth in, especially because it's an international industry and a lot of other countries don't have the restrictions that we do. So you see these developments in other countries where they're just like, holy crap, even everything from vineyards in France, giant corn farms across Europe, everything there.
The Japanese and the Australians have been using them for agriculture for almost 20 years. One of the largest, he said, agriculture is certainly probably the largest future business for drone operations. I think AUVSI has looked at the estimations and whatever you chalk the number up, and you hear a lot of different numbers. So by 2026, we'll pick a round number, $15 billion worth of industry revenue in the United States. $13.5 billion of that is going to be in agricultural support. Either crop support, crop surveillance analysis, anything along those lines. It's certainly the biggest player. But there's infrastructure management from power grid management, physical infrastructure like roadway survey, railways, bridges.
Bridge inspection, crane inspection.
Yeah, and a lot of the technologies that we're utilizing in our heavy lift applications really marry well into those advancements in other markets.
Search and rescue is going to be a big one, too. You think now they send out an aircraft that does a grid pattern. You could release 30 drones that all do their own segment and find somebody ultimately faster. This is like asking someone in 1983 what computers would be used for in 10 years.
Right.
I think none of us have any idea, really.
Yeah. I don't know. This is some pretty good ideas, I think.
Yeah.
We talked to one person, or I've heard it, someone tell me this, that we spoke to someone who herds elephants with them because they hate the sound of the whirring rotors. So that sort of gives you an example of, you'd never...
What's the estimates on elephant herding? How many billions?
Across the Serengeti and throughout Africa, they do tremendous amount of game management, poacher prevention, using not only just flyover visual sensors, but flying acoustical sensors during the prime poaching hours that can pick up the shotgun blast or gun blast, and they can zone in an area and really.
Sorry, my one follow up is, so some of these things we were talking about, like having drones up for long periods of time, that seems to presume that we're going to see are there drones today that have like an internal combustion engine, and so they're staying?
Yeah.
Okay,
so
they put up, you know, gas them up, and they're up for a few hours.
Well, the one you were speaking about, the Japanese and the Australians, that has
The K-Max is a it looks like a standard helicopter, only it's been in the dryer for too long.
That's what Colin was talking about. Like, how are we defining drones? Right. I think for what we're talking about in terms of production, it's a very specific subset of small UAS, small unmanned aerial systems, which the FAA is regulating 55 pounds or less.
Right.
When you talk about
most
drones,
they're going to be battery powered as opposed to
When you talk about drones in general, the drones that you hear about with the military I've been around them. They're twice the size of this stage.
Yeah.
We're not talking about something someone's going to put in their garage. These things are massive. They're gas. They can fly thousands of miles. Surrogate flying. It's a whole different world.
Yeah.
Film, you know. The largest one we have is about a 5-foot diameter.
Yeah.
The fixed-wing aircraft lends themselves more to the longer time up there, some gas engine ones, but then those also require more skill. Because like a DJI product, you just let go of the controls and the thing sits there.
This is the perfect audience for this, is that the video that Michael just showed, if you're looking at hiring a drone company and you see a lot of people out there with DJI, like a Phantom, hover it, fly it, get a really cool shot with a GoPro, that's not the way it's going to happen on set. If you're anticipating hiring a drone company and using them on set, you need to treat it as any other camera system. Rehearsals are involved. I can't tell you how many times we're hired, we say, we're going to need a few rehearsals, and you show up, they're like, we'll just get the shot. And it doesn't work that way. Yeah. I mean, if you're going to allow a techno crane 5 to 6 times to get a shot, decide they want to change the lens, rebalance your Libra head, go do it again, it's a new rehearsal, we can get shots that no one else can. And I promise you that's possible. But as a producer, or if you're a director, DP, you cannot anticipate putting one of these up in the air. And again, that's a cut, edited, awesome reel of some great flying. I'll promise you that wasn't in one take, I'm sure.
They were outside of line of sight, so legally it couldn't have been one take.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of things that you got to think about. Know that a drone will get you the shot you want, but do not anticipate this is some child's toy that anyone can throw up in the air and achieve exactly what you want in one take. There's planning involved.
Remind them how expensive a helicopter would be, and then they'll let you do it 30 times.
10 grand for 4 hours or whatever our rate is.
All right, so questions from you.
Do you folks envision any differences in the FAA regulations between, you know, what I use, which is a Phantom, which is in essence an RC helicopter, which is line of sight, and an actual, you know, more than a quadcopter or an actual drone that flies beyond the horizon or beyond like 500 feet? Are there going to be bifurcated regulations, or am I going to be regulated the same way an actual drone that flies over the horizon is?
And are you talking about for hobbyist use or for commercial use?
For small films. I mean, what I do is I don't charge for the drone footage. I charge for the editing, right?
Right.
Oh, nice loophole.
That's a very common way to get around that. It's like, right.
Yeah, I think they'll put the clamp down on that eventually. But I think you will see it split up. The FAA is making a big push to do what's called ADS-B. So every aircraft's going to have basically a transmitter that sends out where they are, that goes to a ground station that then sends that back out to every other aircraft. I think as you see drones getting bigger, they're going to require that's on there, and then eventually potentially radios on, so the ground operator can speak to an air traffic controller and get permission to enter that Logan Bravo airspace. And they'll make some distinction between the hobbyist that probably doesn't have to have a transponder and a radio, and eventually the larger drones that will be viewed really like equivalent to flying a small passenger aircraft.
Especially for the beyond line of sight
stuff. Right, absolutely, yeah.
So that distinction really, I mean, it's not really there. It's not as heavy, obviously, as the commercial versus hobbyist yet. The FAA is still trying to figure out how to mitigate these two things. But once we get to, you've got commercial and hobbyists, and then once the drones themselves actually get to fly themselves better and beyond line of sight becomes way more viable, then I think the FAA is absolutely going to have to say, okay, yeah, we need to have, you know, information constantly going back between the drone that you have that you can't see that you're flying or is flying itself and all the other drones and aircrafts that are in that space.
So much of the national airspace hinges on the idea of see and avoid. And if I am under visual flight rules, I have to be looking for other aircraft and avoiding it. It's my responsibility to do that. If you're out of visual line of sight, then you no longer can do that. So they're going to hold you to a whole set of rules that would require you to be able to either them to know constantly where you are, or you be able to somehow see and avoid through camera systems or something. Yeah. But if it's within visual line of sight, they can sort of write that off as, well, now the onus is on you to make sure you're not around any other aircraft.
Yeah, all of the rules are kind of, they're broken up into VFR, IFR, in terms of aviation. It's, are you doing it by visual or instrument? And there's separate rules and regulations for either. So it'll flow over eventually.
Yeah.
So as the technology advances, you're seeing a lot more automation in a lot of drones. And I mean, I think there's one that we're looking at that you just kind of throw it up in the air and it follows you around and you can have, there's preset settings.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And
that's the Lily drone?
That's the Lily.
Yeah. The Lily, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so to what extent does automation affect the regulation and has it caught up? Is it going as fast as drone development or are we behind? Or I mean, isn't that going to help with all these problems?
The Phantom 3, the DJI, which is probably the most popular drone, just came out with all kinds of autonomous functions now. And I think the FAA is leaning on their sort of, the pilot in command is responsible. It's, and even when you open those functions in DJI, it says, this is your problem, basically, it's like a disclaimer. I think they're leaning on now that it's your problem. If it flies into something, it's as if you were controlling it and you're going to go to jail or be fined or whatever. But to that point, they're using that as sort of like a cover everything. And at long term, that's just not going to work. There's going to be some other regulatory structure around autonomous flight.
Yeah, and it goes outside of even just the drone aviation world. I mean, you get into any autonomous system, and drones, for better or for worse, have a huge military background. And you look at military operations, whether they're unmanned ships, unmanned weapons, smart bombs, you know, where's the responsibility for whatever action it has decided to take on its autonomous plan become the responsibility of whoever threw it up in the air or whoever pushed it out into the water. And so those regulations will be a lot harder to come to a final point because it's an enormous ethical question that we still haven't resolved in the industry to begin with. Never mind getting to the point where, you know, our micro drone that we do our pilot training with does the same feature. You know, I can put my cell phone in my back pocket and walk around with the sticks in my hand and make them think that I know what I'm doing. It's like, hey, look, it's following me, you know. But so those technologies are certainly available, and their application, in certain, specifically in cinematography, there's some great opportunities. Like, you know, if you have the phone sitting in that car and the car just drives down the dirt road and your drone follows it automatically, that's great. If the autonomous system decides a really good camera angle and can take in the effect which way the light is coming and also knows, you know, where that tree and bridge are, you can't pull that off on every set or every shot. And, you know, I think some of the regulations are set that way intentionally to keep us safe and to keep you guys safe when you're underneath us. But given the fact that the technologies still need to mature a little bit and we need to decide how those technologies are going to be put into the system is really what's going to prevent that from coming to happen real quick.
It's the variables inside of, in terms of filming, in terms of a professional cinematographic environment. Being able to program things has existed for years in remote heads and this type of equipment. And I can say from personal experience that because of the variabilities of the set, because of the human variables of where talent is landing and how this whole complex choreography that is a movie shot comes together, that pre-programmed stuff stays off about 98% of the time. You know, it's we deal with humans, we deal with variables, and so it at least on our end, at least on the cinematographic end of the industry, it's limited.
There's a question up in the front, and then can maybe go back. I see there's one in the back there. Go ahead.
I think the question almost already came up. So you said the moment you get paid to fly a drone, you fall into this professional category. But what happens to the small independent, you know, filmmaker who is just using a few drone shots but is not charging for flying a drone? It's just adding the drone footage to
like in
its
your hypothetical
repertoire.
They own a drone, they borrow it from a friend.
Exactly, or may not use it in the project, but maybe I have it in my toolkit. Does it make me a professional fall? In which category am I?
Don't crash it. You don't have to answer that question.
We are getting paid for the work. I mean, we're getting paid.
I'm doing, but you're getting paid
for that footage.
Yeah, you're getting paid for the footage.
That would be right. They've already said if it's incidental to your business, it still counts as commercial use.
Yeah. So we fall in your...
In the FAA, I'm not FAA.
No, of course.
My interpretation of that would be, yes, you would end up falling in under that. I mean, even in independent, my background is film. I have a soft spot for making movies and getting shots that people want.
Yeah.
We have many different drones. We have scaled rates. If we're flying our largest drone that's the most expensive. It's the trickiest shot. We're submitting a lot of paperwork to the FAA. We're flying literally $70,000, $80,000 under the rig.
Yeah.
That's one rate. If you want to get a quick shot with a Phantom 3, it's a much different rate. Okay. So I would always encourage you to reach out to a company who is exempt and go that route and try that first to see if it's something that can fulfill what you want.
Christopher, this is pointed in your direction. You started to talk a little bit about the gap in expectations between production and what you guys do in terms of blocking shots, rehearsing. I was hoping you could talk a little bit more about that gap in terms of logistical and safety considerations that you guys make pre-flight and before you even get to set, and then when you're on set, and how you deal and communicate with, you know, productions that really want this shot, but you have wind conditions that just came up or okay. something along that.
Definitely. I mean, how many people in here work physically on set? Good. Okay. So a lot of you understand what the conditions are often like. And what we do ahead of time is we have a long discussion with UPM, creative producer, director, DP, and also specifically the locations department. We don't agree to do, they have shots in their mind. We want to do a shot of, you know, the POV of a car going across a bridge. Do we own the bridge? No, shot's not going to happen. I mean, there's some very clear-cut lines. We also don't agree to anything unless the location has been picked, because then we can scout the location. We can go out, we could spend a day scouting all of the locations, hopefully with the DP along our side saying, this is what I'm imagining. What size lens are we on? How high are we gonna have to be? Are you picturing us, you know, following the vehicle? Is it just an overhead tracking shot? Does the vehicle leave frame? We try to get as specific as we can before. When it comes time to dealing with the difference between that day and then the day of, we've designed our own contract that states specifically what's going to happen due to weather conditions, what we're willing to fly in and what we're not willing to fly in. We put everything in writing. Once they agree to that, when we show up on set that day, and this is where, I know Michael, Colin, we're 333 exempt, all of us, you know, that's running a company. There are very specific things that the FAA, and this is why they want commercial applications regulated a bit, is if they have a pilot on set and in command, that they will then know what the parameters are. How close can I be to a building legally, according to the FAA? What are the wind conditions? What are the visibility conditions? When should we call this and put it on the ground, and when should we not? It's honestly, it comes down to experience, and it comes down to having the right education. We, earlier this week, pulled out of a production. We didn't want to. We were running into issues with the FAA. At the end of the day, it's not going to benefit us, and especially not going to benefit the production if they get shut down.
And was that an example of just somebody wanting a kind of shot that you weren't going to get?
That was an example of locations changing a little too last minute for us to be in good communication with the FAA. And again, this is understanding the production world. Things change while you're in the air. I mean, and then you say, okay, we're going to bring it down, we're going to land it, we're going to talk about this. And a lot of that, I think, comes from, one, having production experience. My background was in practical special effects. High-risk environment, a lot of safety concerns, and also my partner has, you know, 25 years, 30 years in special effects. So we're very familiar with dealing with directors, DPs, producers, demands, and now it's using a new set of rules and regulations to still make sure everything is safe and goes off. I know this isn't a direct answer to what you're saying, but there's a lot of steps. It begins as soon as the production meetings start, and as soon as they call you for questions, and then you have to be very active and clear in what you're willing to do and what you're not willing to do. Mm-hmm. When it comes time to the shooting day, you have to stick to that as best you can. And I will say, there are small instances where it's not exactly what they asked for, but you understand that in production things change. you can get a lens up in the air, and then a DP goes, you know what, we gotta do this differently. It's not what I imagined, or I've got a new, better, great idea. This is exactly what I imagined, but hold on. This is gonna be the trailer. And then you work with them and try to get them the shot as long as you're within, you know, your safety constructs, and you can maintain that shot without, you know, hurting your own company or any people or the production.
All right, let's try it again, and we're sort of running short
of
time.
Sorry, that was a long one.
Michael, no, but I bet he had an important thing, and I'm gonna interject this shortly, because what he's talking about, actually, is I get feedback from all of our different aerial teams. It's one of the most significant problems they have with production is production calling several different flight teams going, I want to do this shot, what's it going to cost? And it isn't that, because of all of the things that he was talking about. You get into an urban environment, maybe you have to do an RF survey to even understand whether or not you're going to be able to fly.
What's
in this
an RF environment. Survey?
Well, in other words, the radio spectrum, what does it look like, and can you actually, because if you have RF problems, you lose control
right.
of your
so
craft.
So you're going to be able to control the,
right.
the
yeah.
drone
yeah.
the entire shot.
On these things, so there are these variables. Okay, sorry, kept it short.
All right, in the middle in blue, and then go ahead. We'll get the mic to you.
Two interrelated questions. One is, does anyone ever talk with the FAA about the inherent confusion about you're putting the most regulations on the people who have the most to learn by flying dangerously and incorrectly, as opposed to anyone who goes, dude, let's see what this can do, and fly it out of the box, and they can fly without restriction, but us who want to fly responsibly have the most restriction placed on us. It seems like it ought to be a little bit backwards. The other one is, it's been sort of mentioned to me that years ago, in order to use a CB radio, you need an FCC ham operator's license, but a million truck drivers said, actually, no, you don't. And so the FCC changed their rules to say, yeah, you don't, but here's the rules. It's been suggested to me that the same thing may be coming with the FAA because they don't have the resources, the people, or the enforcement budgets to keep track of the hundreds of thousands of drones that are appearing across the country with another 150,000 more this Christmas. I mean, any feedback?
Michael?
Yeah.
Jeff, why don't you jump in? You've been quiet.
Well, yeah, thanks. with the FAA, I mean, their mandate is going to be pushed harder and harder to put more regulations in place. And if there's one thing a federal government or agency loves is being able to push their budget up hugely with justification. Looking at the economics of what the industry would bring, not only, like I said, in the cinematography, but in every element of our daily lives, there's going to be a tremendous demand. There are applications that are being pushed forward that will exceed what our current best vision is, and so they will get more funding. The FAA will be able to stand up, establish an enforcement program, whether it's through their own offices or through just working with local state and local police to be their eyes in the field and be their reporters. As far as the first side, where you're talking about the regulations of just a kid grabs it off the shelf and throws it up in the air versus people who are operating them commercially with good intent. The problem there is the FAA doesn't actually have the authority to manage that recreational group. They can make very strong recommendations, and their most recent recommendation was a tersely worded letter of like what you should and should not do, and it really pushes forth the idea of like if you're a recreational flyer, then you should belong to a flight club that has a set flight field and operates under certain conditions. We all know that's not going to happen. You're going to get the thing for Christmas, and you're not going to wait to join the local fly club. You're going to go out in the football field down the street and do it.
Right, right. I mean, the analogy, I was just thinking about, like, you know, the person who buys a jet ski and, you know, is buzzing around Boston Harbor is probably just as unregulated as the person who gets their drone for Christmas. And then, you know, a person who's running a water taxi is obviously going to be much more.
Yeah, well, I mean, and those vehicles still need, even if you buy a recreational water sports vehicle, you have to get it registered. You still have to put an MS number on the hull.
Right.
You know, so there's some regulations to it. You don't have to be licensed to drive it.
Right.
I worked in boat yards when I was younger, and I saw people bringing in ships that had no business driving, but they had the money to buy it, so they got out and did it.
Yeah.
I think when the regulatory process is going to get refined, the FAA understands it needs to, you know, move ahead faster than they have. Federal regulations take a very long time to get designed and implemented.
So you don't see the FAA throwing in the towel on the exemption requirement and replacing it with a strict set of rules?
Well, the exemption requirement is a Band-Aid right now.
Right. That's
until they get the regulations settled. They will have they will have regulations that will be very clear-cut, the same as if you want to register and fly your Piper Cub. You'll have to go through the same program.
Just pass the mic in front. There you go.
The sad reality is accidents are what's going to drive this whole thing.
Right. Sadly.
And there's multiple industries fighting here. It's not like it's the FAA and everyone's saying, we want regulations. There's massive industries saying, we don't want any regulations. Do you think DJI wants everyone to have to require a license to buy one of their products? I mean, there's a big battle at a much higher level of people involved.
Let's see if we can get one or two last questions in. Go ahead.
Great, thanks a lot. I'm going to take this back to the intersection of the drone technology and usage and motion picture film. Our 33 exemption, we had the closed set and motion picture included in it. And what I'm wondering about is this really going to be important to people who are making films to have to have that addendum on there? And the second part of it is, to bring it back into this, when is it going to get unionized? I would think that would go to you.
Thank you. I can do this in a couple different directions. I can tell you on the West Coast, it is substantially unionized. We're working on the East Coast. Cinematographically, okay, I'll try to make this really quick. This is a new vernacular in the language of cinematography, in the same way that Steadicam, which started off being, gee whiz, I can run with the camera. The technology became more sophisticated, people started to understand creatively how to work with the tool, and it became its own kind of shot, to where now you're looking at a script and you go, ah, this is a Steadicam shot. The same thing is going to be happening with this technology. And as such, it's going to become, as people learn how to use it, more and more important. You know, the Guild did a presentation at the Directors Guild mid-July, and part of what the Directors Guild wants to do is sit down in small groups with aerial cameramen to be able to understand how the directors can use this, because all of a sudden we've liberated the airspace between 2 feet and 400 feet, and we are capable of designing entirely new kinds of shots. I had a montage, I don't think it got run here, but it's put together of all of these different kinds of things that we have no other way of doing that kind of shot, and we need that, and that capability will be used in our visual language when it comes to telling stories. Now, you had another part of your question, and I'm I can pretty much guarantee from the Guild, we are part of the Labor Industry Safety Committee, and we're getting ready to actually come out with the first safety bulletin on this, and I can say that for the foreseeable future, the 333 exemption and a pilot's license is going to be required to work on closed set filming.
Also, there's two reasons our company gets hired. Three, our experience in production in general are real, and we get many calls specifically because we have a 333. Sony has compiled a list, Universal's compiled a list of companies that have 333s, and they're the only people they will call.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it has directly impacted in a positive way our business.
Okay.
Even if the FAA eliminates those rules, the industry has already decided to keep them.
Right. Okay. All right, so let's see if we can get one or two last questions. Green striped shirt in the front there.
So as we all know, the technology surrounding drones is going to continue to advance over the next, you know, many years. And that means that the capabilities of the drones in cinematography, you know, people will be capable of making far more advanced shots and doing far more advanced things with them. How hard is it for companies like this to keep up with the latest advances in technologies? Because I have a feeling that, you know, in coming years, it's only going to grow exponentially, and are the companies going to have any trouble keeping up?
Yeah, I mean, it's a tech company in some ways, and the costs are astronomical. I mean, to fly a heavy lift drone, each battery is $500, $300 to $500, and you're looking at four batteries per 10-minute flight. So you're looking at $2,000 potentially up in the air for each 10 minutes of fly time. I mean, that you need to have $6,000, $8,000 worth of batteries on set with you. And again, that's not much different than the batteries for cameras cost in terms of, sorry.
It's all right.
In terms of like Panavision batteries, and you know, the costs are kind of comparable within this industry, but it's high. I mean, our drones are not, our custom drones that, like, we build our own, it's expensive.
Just going to get harder and harder to keep up as the technology advances.
Well, I don't know, but technology also tends to get less expensive over time, right? So those batteries, you know, the batteries that are on our cell phones today, like, you wouldn't be able to buy that for any amount of money 10 years ago.
You could probably make a full-time job out of reading blogs and trying to keep up with just what's out there to even spend your money on, much less if you have the money or not.
Right. I'm thinking that when the technology becomes, you know, more advanced, there are going to be film companies that are going to be wanting the newest and best thing, and that means that some company is going to have to put in the resources to learn how to do it.
And the money you put into those resources right now need to be turned over in rapid, you know, within a 2-year window, because the next piece of equipment that's going to come along, you know, I'm sure you guys all had the same experience. You know, when we started our company, we had one airframe that we followed and worked with for about 6 months, and then all of a sudden, that was obsolete.
Yeah.
You know, move on to the next thing. And Amazon went through the same thing. That was their biggest argument, even after they were given a 333 exemption to do their package delivery testing, was that they said, by the time we went through the 120-day minimum process to get this license, this airframe was not only obsolete, but it was already thrown in the bottom of the dumpster and stomped on several times. Yeah. So the
number of airframes they've been through are in the double digits already.
Yeah, so, so as technology advancements, you know, put a lot of pressure on us to stay on the cutting edge, and it's, you know, it's part of being in the business. If you're going to be serious about being in the business, you're going to stay on that cutting edge as best you can and try and, you know, reap your rewards quickly with what you have in hand.
You'll see this, the same intellectual property battles you see between Apple and Samsung, too, you know, because it gives you such a competitive advantage.
I will say that one of the things that is unique about cinematography, and I think one of the things that is slightly unique about cinematography, is it is a talent-based industry. When you look at scanning crops, or, you know, you're using waypoints, you're using a base station, your equipment matters, your talent in understanding the equipment matters, that's about where it dies. With cinematography, you have to know your equipment, you have to be talented with your equipment, but you have to be able to get shots, film. I mean, there's a different level of the reasons why you get hired. And I think, you know, with anything, if you started off with cheap equipment and you get very good at it, and you can produce things that no one else can, that is a benefit of this industry.
I agree with you, but 20 years from now, we'll be listening to that saying, oh, that's archaic. A computer can target the moving object, read the lighting, and give you a way better shot than even
eventually,
the best artist.
Yeah, you know? Of course. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a worrisome prediction.
Everyone retire now.
So does someone have a really quick question that not everybody's going to feel compelled to answer on the panel, and we can get the microphone to you quickly? Does that describe, or does someone back there already? All right. In the sport coat right there by the microphone. And after we wrap up, maybe we should show that montage that Michael was talking about. And other people who have questions can come up and ask them one-on-one. But go ahead, last question.
Chris, I think you were talking about the geofencing thing that was already ruled as illegal because you're basically stealing somebody else's drone. But do you see that developing as kind of a limiting factor as drones develop?
I don't know if I quite... What do you mean by a limiting factor?
Well,
you mean like flying deterrents,
I think
basically?
It's like 3DR or maybe the Lily Cam. They have that geofencing where you can basically trap the
drone. I see what you're saying. So like even DJI, everything pretty much has geofencing.
Okay.
Where from its own position, you set up a fence around you. What I was talking about more is there are now corporate companies, large companies saying, what if we wanted to fence off the White House? And nothing will be allowed into that space. It's already illegal to fly over Fenway. Fenway could institute a geofence around itself, eliminating drones, or if a drone enters that airspace, to take control of it.
Yeah.
And I think there's kind of two different sides to that.
But DJI, or, I mean, they already, if you fly towards an airport, the thing will just stop. So it does provide some limiting factors, but there's always a hack around all of this stuff. So it's never going to be the end-all, be-all answer to our problems, you know?
I'm imagining, like, Fenway taking control of the drone and landing it on, like, the visiting pitcher, you know?
Yeah.
This could ensure a much better 2016 season.
If it's New York.
All right, thank you for all the great questions. Please come up and talk to people after. Great panel, guys.